Good morning. Let's try that again. Good morning. There you go. You all sound great this morning. Welcome to New Baptist Church. We are glad that you are here with us. If you are new to this church, we are glad that you joined us this morning. Up on the screen, there's a QR code. If you take a smartphone and the camera and point it at that square, it'll take you to a card online that you can fill out and just let us know you were here with us this morning. We would love the opportunity of being able to follow up with you. Also, that's a great place to be able to share prayer requests and other things for us to know that you were here. We are glad that you are with us. New Baptist is a place where we want to know Christ. We want to grow in His Word, and we want to be a blessing wherever He places us. And one of the ways that we care for one another, we grow in God's Word, is through our Sunday school program. And so a Sunday school meets before worship each Sunday morning. And so I want to invite you to come back next week and be a part of a Sunday school class. And if you're not sure which one to attend, there are classes for all ages and stages. Ask the folks around you what class they go to, and maybe you can join them next week. Some of them even have breakfast, so just to know that in the back of your mind. Also, I want to invite you to come back on Wednesday evening. Wednesday, we have our children's and our youth program. Both of those start at 6 o'clock, and then Bible study starts at 6:30, so come back and be a part of that. We, throughout the season, leading up towards Christmas, have been focusing on Operation Christmas Child. And there are a list of dates and things coming up in the future for Operation Christmas Child. But also wanted just a special note for you. Out in the welcome area, there are some multicolored cards. Or you can personalize this if you've, maybe you and your family have built boxes and brought stuff in. You can take a picture. We're actually doing that with the youth group, and the different groups have done that. Taking pictures, and then on the back of the picture, write a card. But in each shoebox we pack, we want to include a note for a child. It could be as simple as Jesus loves you, or I prayed for you as I packed this box. And you can use your own card, you can use the back of a picture, or you can use these multicolored cards that are out in the Welcome Center. Write your own note while you're here. You could take some home and write them while you're at home, and then bring them back next week and put them in the shoebox on the tables in the lobby. And your note will make it to the shoebox and make it a little bit more personal. And so that's just a way for the people that receive those to know that somebody, a real human, actually packed this and is actually thinking about them and caring for them. And just a way for us just to show the love of Jesus as the good news spreads around the world. So we're excited about all of that. I know this past week our college students packed shoeboxes, and that was a great opportunity. Thank you for all of your contributions and your prayers and your work to be able to be a part of this great missional project. As we go through our worship service today, we just want to begin with God's Word. And so if you would stand with me, we are memorizing Psalm 19 this year. And so the words are up on the screen. I want to invite you to recite Psalms 119, verses 1 through 10. Let's say it all together, starting at verse 1. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the sky above proclaims His handiwork. Day to day pours out speech, and night to night reveals knowledge. There is no speech, nor are there words, whose voice is not heard. Their voice goes out through all the earth, and their words to the end of the world. In them He has set a tent for the sun, which comes out like a bridegroom leaving his chamber, and like a strong man runs its course with joy. Its rising is from the end of the heavens, and its circuit to the end of them. And there is nothing hidden from its heat. The law of the Lord is perfect, reviving the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The rules of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. More to be desired are they than gold, even much fine gold, sweeter also than honey dripping from the honeycomb. Join me as we pray this morning. Lord God, thank you for this day. I thank you for the opportunity to come to gather here in this place to worship your name. God, to proclaim your word as we recite it and memorize it. And God, as we hear it read and taught this morning. God, come and be near us as we hear you speak. God, transform us to make us a blessing wherever you place us. And God, we thank you for the many ways that you bless us, and we just say thank you here at the beginning of our service for all those things. And God, this morning, as there are worries and burdens and sadness that we might carry with us this morning, I pray that you might carry those for us, that we can worship you and know the goodness of who you are. And God, we pray just for this time, and we want to honor you and praise you and thank you for all that you do. We love you, and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning. If you all remain standing as we begin to worship. Wake up to him. greet those around.
Since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and sin which clings so closely, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the founder and the perfecter of our faith, who, for the joy that was set before him, endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God.
If you'll join me this morning in prayer, we are going to use the Lord's Prayer as our template to pray this morning. Let's pray. God, our Father, you are great, you are holy, and you are mighty. God, we thank you for who you are, and we give you all of the praise and glory. God, we pray right now for your will to be done in this world. God, for your will to be done in our lives. God, as we lift up the things that we have concern for, God, the things that we are sad about, the things that we are worried about, God, the things that we see that are broken, that need fixed, God, we lift these things up to you, asking your will to be done. And God, we take this time to thank you for the many ways that you provide for us. God, we thank you for each meal and each breath that we have. God, we thank you for the ways that we can just live on a day-to-day basis. And God, we thank you for this church and the place where we can be that seeks to be a blessing. God, I thank you for those who give on a regular basis to be able to provide for the ministry inside and outside the walls of this church. And God, we offer our thanks for those things and seek your direction as we use and lead and do the things that you've called us to. God, we take this time to confess our sins to you as we recognize how great you are and holy you are. God, we pale in comparison. And God, we see our own brokenness and sinfulness. And God, as we think about the things that we have done willfully or accidentally, God, the things that we have failed to do, we confess these things to you right now. And we thank you for your forgiveness, and we know that you are loving and gracious, and we receive that forgiveness. And as we receive it, we also forgive those who have sinned against us. God, to bring about restored relationships. God, we trust you and ask that you will help us to have the strength to forgive others. God, protect us and guard us and guide us now, we pray, in the decisions we need to make. God, the day-to-day steps that we take. God, just in our time here this morning, we ask for your presence and your protection and to direct our mind to you, to direct our mind towards living for you. And God, we give you the praise. We give you the praise for lives that are committed to you through baptism today. God, we give you praise for your word and your presence and the ability to sing praise to you and to be able to hear your word proclaimed in our language that we might know you and walk with you. And be with us today and throughout this week, we ask in Jesus' name, amen.
Well, today we have the opportunity and blessing to come to the waters of baptism. We have two young lives who are being baptized. I would like to read to you from the book of Romans. Paul is writing, and he says, "Do you not know that all of us who've been baptized into Christ Jesus have been baptized into his death? Therefore, we have been buried with him through baptism into death, in order that as Christ was raised from the dead, through the glory of the Father, so we too might walk in newness of life. For if we have become united with him in the likeness of his death, certainly we shall be also in the likeness of his resurrection." Today, Evan Willis and Abby Willis are being baptized. They have met actually with their grandmother for a number of months, for quite a while, just going through scripture and studying God's word. Aren't grandparents important? Amen. and so both of these, I've met with both Evan and Abby, and they have shared their faith with me, and they have come here now to profess to you their decision to follow the Lord. So I'm going to invite Evan, you come first, please. Evan, have you received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
Is it your intention to follow him the rest of your days of your life?
Yes.
Evan, upon your confession of faith, I baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. I pray for you. Gracious Father, I pray for Evan. I lift him up to you. I pray your hand upon him. I pray that you pour out your spirit upon him, that you protect him and guide him and grow yourself in him, Father. Grip him by your hands and lead him in your ways. In Christ's name, amen. I'd like to invite Abby Willis. Abby, have you received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
Is it your intention to follow him the rest of the days of your life?
Yes.
Abby, upon your confession of faith, I baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We pray for you. Gracious Father, I lift Abby up to you. I ask your spirit upon her. I pray that your hand will hold her. I pray that you will grow in her a desire and longing for all things that are yours. Lord, I pray that you protect her in these days and that you grow her to be a mighty woman of God. We thank you in Christ's name. Amen.
In the
Thank you, Nina. I'd like our kids to stand up. And children, you are dismissed to Children's Church. Let's please give them a round of applause as they go out. And as they are going out, I apologize for the heat. I think there's something wrong with our thermostat, so they're working on it right now to cool it down in here some. In our story that we will see in Scripture in just a moment, there is a young man who fell asleep in church, and it didn't go well for him. So don't fall asleep today here. Well, it's good to be back. I've been gone for 2 Sundays, and a little over a week ago, my first grandson was born. Can I show you a picture? There he is. Can I show you another picture? There's another picture right there. I have like 600 photos. I could just go on here. His name is Theophilus David Eastman. If you turn to the very first verse of the book of Acts, the book that we're in right now, also in the book of Luke, you will see that Luke, the author, is writing to a Theophilus. And the name Theophilus means loved by God. And we're not going to call him Theophilus all the time. We're going to call him normally just Theo. And Theo is the genitive form of the word God. And it simply means of God or from God. So that's his name, Theo, from the normal way that we will be calling him. So there's baby Theo. He and both his mother and father are doing well. Well, today we are in the book of Acts. We're actually in Acts chapter 20. And Acts chapter 20 marks the end of what I would call part 2 of Acts. If Acts was a play, or if it was a drama, or if it was a TV series, there would be 3 seasons. And season 1, part 1, would be the rapid growth of the Jerusalem church, the persecution upon the Jerusalem church, and the gospel going out from the Jerusalem church into Judea and into Samaria. Acts 1, roughly 12, 13 years. The second part, the second season of Acts 2, part 2, would be what we've been in for the past number of weeks. It would be Paul's missionary journeys. It's the gospel now going out from Judea, Samaria, now into the world. And there we have walked through the 3 missionary journeys of Paul. It lasts roughly 10 years, those journeys do. And we are now coming to the end. In fact, we are today of his 3rd missionary journey. And thus, fittingly, today we're going to hear Paul's farewell address, his farewell speech to the elders of Ephesus, but I think in a way to those churches that he has been ministering at. And then in the weeks to come, we'll enter into part 3, which is Paul's arrest, his imprisonment, and his journey to Rome, the gospel going to Rome. So that's the just a very simple outline of the book of Acts. We are in part 2. And in part 2, we have Paul's farewell address. And there's a question I'd like to ask you right here. If you knew you were going away and the people that you love you would never see again, what would you say to them? What would you say to them? Well, this is what Paul's doing. It's his farewell address. This is the last time he's going to see these people. And so a very simple summary of what he says is, number 1, he tells the people how his life has been changed by Jesus Christ. Number 2, he encourages them to keep fast, to hold the course, to be alert. And number 3, he entrusts them to the Lord and he prays for them. It's a good template. I'm going to use it. Telling people what Christ has done, be encouraged, and to entrust them to the Lord. Let's begin this time with prayer. Gracious Father, I thank you for today. I thank you for just the celebration of new life. Let that be life that is born, or new life, life that is born of you. We thank you for those who were baptized today. And Lord, as we just think for the moment of saying goodbye to those that we love, I'm reminded of Mike Kelly's passing this morning and those words of goodbye that have been spoken by him to others. He knew he was leaving, and he said goodbye, Father, and I pray that you will bless those words. Be with us this morning as we open up your word. May your word be a source of comfort, encouragement, and challenge to us today. In Christ's name, amen. Well, Acts chapter 19 ends with a massive riot filling the city streets of Ephesus. The riot was prompted by the idol-making silversmiths. The people of Ephesus were enraged that Paul had said gods made with human hands are not gods. And I'm sure Paul said that many times. And for 2 hours, a massive crowd filled with anger in this giant coliseum, this giant theater, just shouting at the top of their lungs, "Great is Artemis of Ephesus!" And finally, the city clerk, the mayor, was able to calm them down through the warning of the charge of rioting. But that didn't mean that Paul was safe. His life was in jeopardy. And so in Acts chapter 20, our passage today, Paul leaves Ephesus. I'm sure he leaves fearing for his life. Our text begins, Acts 20. After the uproar ceased, Paul sent for the disciples, and after encouraging them, he said farewell and departed for Macedonia. Well, he had gone through those regions, had given them much encouragement. He came to Greece. There he spent 3 months, and when a plot was made against him by the Jews as he was about to set sail for Syria, he decided to return through Macedonia. Just a few details there. Greece is where Corinth is located at. This would make Paul's third trip to Corinth. And it's during these 3 months in Corinth that he probably wrote the letter to Romans. And that's just a part of I think it helps gets texture to our passage today. I'm going to jump now to verse 6. Luke is now with this group, and he gives a lot of travel logs. I'm skipping some of his travel log and moving to verse 6. We came to them at Troas, where we stayed for 7 days. On the first day of the week, when we were gathered together to break bread, Paul talked with them, intending to depart on the next day. And he prolonged his speech until midnight. There were many lamps in the upper room where we were gathered. I love that first-person detail that Luke adds. I can just envision that. And a young man named Eutychus, sitting at the window, sank into a deep sleep as Paul talked still longer. Now, Paul had just written the book to Romans. What do you think he was talking about? He was sharing the book of Romans, right? I can just imagine how wonderful it must have been to be in that third story room. And being overcome by sleep, he fell down from the third story and was taken up dead. But Paul went down, bent over him, and taking him in his arms, said, "Do not be alarmed, for his life is in him." And when Paul had gone up and had broken bread and eaten, he conversed with them a long while until daybreak, and so departed. And they took the youth away alive and were not a little comforted. I love that story told by Luke in the first person. A young man tragically dies. Paul goes down, performs a miracle, brings him back to life, eats a sandwich, and then goes back to teaching. I mean, that's awesome. That's great. The lesson here, don't fall asleep in church. Stay awake. Reading on. The next day, Paul sails from Troas, and after more travelogue given by Luke, he stops at a place of Miletus, and it's there that Paul calls the elders of the church of Ephesus to come and meet him there. This is verse 17 now. Now from Miletus he sent to Ephesus and called the elders of the church to come to him. And when they came to him, he said to them, what he says to them is Paul's final farewell to the church, to them, and I'm sure to other churches. And the first thing that Paul shares with them is how the Lord changed his life. Now, before we read this passage, I want to ask you a question. Those are all the same question there, just said in different ways. And the question is this: how has God in Christ changed you? How is your life different because you are a follower of Jesus? How has your life in Christ, filled with the Spirit, been transformed? Take a moment. Consider how you would express God's transforming work in your life. A number of years ago, when Jacob was around 12 years old, I took him to a Christian rock concert at the old field house here in Huntington. The concert was put on by a local ministry, I forget who it was, and that ministry felt that there had to be a gospel presentation given before the concert could begin. And so at that gospel presentation, which I'm all for, a woman stood up and talked for an hour about all the nasty things that she has done. It was a PG-13 rated R testimony. And I'm thinking, why? I'm trying to shut my son's ears. Stop listening to this testimony. She glorified her sins, drugs and sex and breaking the law, more than she glorified what Jesus has done for her. At the end of it all, nearly after an hour of talking just about her sins, she finally got around to say, accept Jesus into your life and he will forgive you of your sins. And that was it. I share this story because I think for a lot of people, they think that all that Christ does for them is some divine accounting trick up there in heaven, moving sins from their ledger column into Christ's ledger column. A heavenly shuffling of papers, but no real earthly change. How has your life changed because of Christ? Paul's testimony is different. What he shares to this group of people emphasizes how deeply God's transformative power has reshaped him. So let me ask you again. How has God in Christ changed your life? How is your life different because you are a follower of Jesus? How has your life in Christ, filled with the Spirit, transformed you? I pondered this question throughout this past week, and I ended up actually compiling a list of 20 ways that God changes a person's life, 20 areas of transformation of God's work brought through his Spirit. And I think there's probably more than 20 areas. I'm sure that list will grow. I'm still working on it. But today, I'm only going to share with you 5. And if you want to know what the other 15 are, come Wednesday night. The 5 I am sharing are those most evident in our passage today, that they are a part of Paul's testimony, part of how he's been changed by God's grace and mercy and purpose. So let's begin looking at Paul's testimony and focus in on the change that has happened to him. Let's read beginning at verse 18 now. Paul now speaks. You yourself know how I lived among you the whole time, from the first day that I set foot in Asia, serving the Lord with all humility and with tears and with trials that happened to me through the plots of the Jews. How I did not shrink from declaring to you anything that was profitable and teaching you in public from house to house, testifying both to Jews and to Greeks of repentance towards God and of faith in our Lord Jesus Christ. And now, behold, I'm going to Jerusalem, constrained by the Spirit, not knowing what will happen to me there, except that the Holy Spirit testifies to me in every city that imprisonment and afflictions await me. In other words, Paul is saying, everywhere I have shared the gospel has resulted in imprisonment and afflictions, and it's not going to change. And to stress this point, really fast review, his first missionary journey, Antioch and Pisidia, Paul and Barnabas were persecuted and driven out. In Iconium, they were mistreated. Some people tried to stone Paul. In Lystra, he was stoned and left for dead. Second missionary journey. In Philippi, he was beaten with rods and placed in prison. In Thessalonica, mobs chased Paul out of the city. Same thing in Berea, mobs chased Paul out of the city. In Corinth, he was bound and brought before the proconsul. And now on this third journey, a massive mob forms against Paul. His life is in danger. In Greece and Macedonia, people are hunting him down, wanting him dead. And now Paul, in his testimony to the church elders, is saying, God's Spirit has said to me that none of this is going to change for me. The imprisonment and afflictions await me. With this in mind, notice what he says next, verse 24. But I do not account my life of any value, nor as precious to myself, if only I may finish my course in the ministry that I received from the Lord Jesus to testify to the gospel of the grace of God. So, how has Paul's life changed? How has his life been transformed since meeting Jesus? We're going to come back to that verse. Verse 25. And now, behold, I know that none of you among whom I have gone about proclaiming the gospel will see my face again. Therefore, I testify to you this day that I am innocent of the blood of all, for I did not shrink from declaring to you the whole counsel of God. I want to stop right here and highlight how Paul has been transformed by Jesus. And I'll do this pretty quick. How his life has been changed since he's met Jesus. And again, these are just five areas, and I have a list of at least 20, so this is just a limited scope, and we can pull out more from here. But here are some things that I think are really clear in this passage. Number one, we see a change in Paul through the enjoyment of the Holy Spirit, power and presence and fellowship. Through Christ, Paul has received the Spirit. And there's fellowship with the Spirit. The Spirit is not only laying upon him what God is going to do with his life, verses 22 and 23 on the screen, but I know the Spirit is also comforting him and giving him strength. And again, I'm going back to Paul has just written the book of Romans. And in the book of Romans, he talks about the Holy Spirit himself praying for him, praying for Paul. And the same is true for you and me. If you are in Christ, the Holy Spirit has been given to you. And by his presence, he encourages, comforts, and convicts. He's the giver of gifts and the grower of fruit. Number two, we also see here in Paul a new heart. A heart that desires and values the things of God over and above the things of this world. And we see this change in Paul very clearly in verse 24, when Paul, in speaking about his suffering, says, I do not account my life of any value, nor as precious to myself. This is not self-hate. He's not thinking low of himself. This is Paul having such a high value of the things of God that has changed his views of his own life. And this change of values, viewing his life through the lens of Christ, has transformed him. Where he was once prideful and zealful for the law, he now lives in humility. Where he was once very important, the best of the best, he is now living a life of self-sacrifice. What once seemed precious to him, reputation and comfort and success, are now meaningless when compared to knowing Christ and following him. The same is true for us. Your life is transformed or will be transformed when it's lived and viewed to the worth of knowing Jesus. Paul writes in Philippians, indeed, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. For his sake, I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish in order that I might gain Christ. Number three, we see in Paul a transformation of his sufferings and trials. And again, I'm pointing to verses 23 and 24 when Paul talks about his sufferings, and then he says, it's okay. It's okay. If only I may finish my course in the ministry that I received from the Lord Jesus to testify to the gospel of the grace of God. Paul's life in Christ is such that not only does he have the strength to persevere through life's trials and tribulations, but I believe he uses them. They are transformed to serve the gospel, to all the glory of God's grace and mercy. And I think the same is true for you and I. The transformation that Jesus brings is not that we escape trials and hardships in this life, but that in him, those trials and hardships are transformed and turned to serve and glorify the Lord. Is that true of you? What are you doing with your pain? What are you doing with your sickness? What are you doing with your heartaches? Christ turns our ashes to beauty. We also see here in this transformation of Paul a hunger for God's word. There's an excitement about God's word that we can see in Paul, and I think it's from him realizing that all of Scripture points to Jesus. So he's just eating Scripture up to see and better know Jesus. And so in his farewell testimony, we see this hunger for God's word come up in a couple of places. One, he says, I did not shrink from you, from declaring to you the whole counsel of God. And that phrase, whole counsel of God, it's the Bible. That's what he's talking about. This is what Paul's talking about. And if we had time, we would go back and look at some of Paul's messages of what he does, of how he opens up the Scriptures to people in order to show them Jesus. The same, I believe, is true for you and me. If you love Jesus, you're going to want to go to where you can meet him, where you can know him, where you can hear him, and that's God's word. For it's there that we see and encounter and hear from him, a love for God's word. Number five, a life that overflows with generosity and with grace. What we've just read, and we'll see it again in what we will read, there's this spirit of generosity that's just always coming out of Paul. And there's always an overflow that's happening in him. And we see it in him when he said about himself, I did everything that I could. I went out of my way. I bore all the expenses to give to you what is profitable. I didn't shrink from declaring to you anything that was profitable. Paul's presence, his words, his life, his teaching, everything overflowed and outflowed of him, not just to Jews, but to Jews and Greeks, to anyone who would receive. And the same is true for you and me. A life that's been transformed by Jesus, transformed by the Lord, is a life that will overflow and will have outflow. The ways of the world is to hang on to things, to protect, is to grab, to gobble up. But the ways of the kingdom is to be open-handed and open-hearted, of caring and loving and listening and giving. These are the ways that we are changed. Now, there are more things in our passage today that we could highlight regarding how Paul has been changed because of Jesus. I've not talked about victory over sin or his purpose and calling or transformed relationships and so on. If you want to hear more about what it looks like to be changed by Christ, come back Wednesday night. I want to move on. Not only do we see in Paul's final farewell his testimony to how he has been changed by the Lord, we also see there an encouragement to stay watchful. Let's read it. This is Acts 20, our next section, verse 28. Pay attention to yourselves and to all the flock in which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers to care for the church which he obtained with his own blood. I know that after my departure, fierce wolves will come in among you, not sparing the flock, and from among your own selves will arise men speaking twisted things to draw away the disciples after them. Therefore, be alert. Remember that for 3 years I did not cease night or day to admonish everyone with tears. The central command here in this passage is verse 31, be alert, which could also be written as be watchful, stay awake, be ready. And Paul tells them why this is so important, because he says clearly, after my departure, fierce wolves will come in among you and from you, speaking twisted things to draw away the disciples after them. In other words, the world's not safe. There are people, external, fierce wolves, internal, some of you, who will manipulate and control and dominate and twist and destroy. Right? Paul writes in Ephesus, or to them, that our battle's not just against, it is not against flesh and blood, but against principalities. So the transformative work of God in you, Paul is saying, there's an evil that wants to diminish that, wants to take that away from you. In Revelation chapter 3:20, Jesus says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with him and he with me. Well, you can't hear Jesus' voice and open the door if you're not home, right? Therefore, to quote Jesus, chapter 24, stay awake. Exact same word Paul's using. For you do not know on what day your Lord is coming. Now, we usually interpret these words of Jesus about staying awake as to his second coming, but they can be applied, they should be applied. Paul's telling us to apply them to everyday life. Live your life alert, being ready, being awake for the presence of God today. Don't be like that young man who falls asleep and dies. Stay awake. Be alert, be watchful, and be ready. So how do you do that? What does it look like to be alert? Well, we all know what it means to be alert when you drive a car, right? Hands on the wheel, eyes looking forward, scanning the road, distant and near, driving at a safe speed, not playing on your phone. And being alert as we drive is not just something that we start when we get into the car. Oh, I've been driving for 10 minutes now. Let me set the cruise control and take a nap. No, right? Sometimes I feel too, I want to do that. You can't. It has to be done the entire journey. It's been a little over 10 years now that I was out on a motorcycle ride. And I made the mistake of putting a cup holder on my motorcycle. Who would put a cup holder on their motorcycle? And I had stopped at Starbucks to get my pumpkin latte. And I was busy. Oh, I'm going to drink this latte. And I took my eyes off for just a moment. And the moment was long enough to just realize the car was stopped in front of me. I wasn't alert. I wasn't paying attention. I laid my bike down and tore up my bike and tore up my body because I was not paying attention. And Paul is saying the exact same thing here about our faith, about our lives. Be alert. Pay attention. Don't take your eyes off of it. Don't just go onto cruise control. You are to stay awake. And so what does that look like? Well, looking at our passage today, there are three things that I think that Paul would say. This is what it means to stay alert. Number one, keep before you God's word. This is the very next thing that Paul says. Verse 31, therefore, be alert, remembering what? For the years I did not cease day, night, or day to admonish everyone with tears. He's pointing them. He's telling them, remember what I taught you. Remember the scriptures that I showed you. Remember all the times that we spent together talking over God's word. Remember that. Don't let go of God's word. Trust his word. How do you keep crashing your life? Know and remember and keep before you God's word. Read it, study it, know it, memorize it. Number two, look what he says back in verse 28. Pay careful attention to yourself. I know some people who drive their car nice and alert, but they don't pay attention to the warning beepers on their dashboard, right? Speed, engine heat, fuel gauge, the inflate tire. I'll just ignore the inflate tire one right there. But these are things, and these are things happening to the car telling you you need to check something. In the same way, there's things happen to us that are indicators that tell us something in us needs attention. We need to check. Feelings are great gauges, and I don't think we should be led by our feelings, but our feelings sure tell us what's going on in us. Why are you angry? Why are you distressed? Where is your anxiety coming from? Seeking to answer those questions often reveals spiritual issues that need to be addressed. Pay attention to oneself involves also checking that check engine light. And man, it's time to repent, right? There's something wrong. It needs to be confessed. And then Paul goes on to say, pay attention to others. That being alert is this not seeing what's happening in your life, but seeing what's happening in the lives of other people. Pay careful attention to yourself and to all the flock. Care for the church, which he obtained with his blood. Paul's talking to the elders of the church, and he says, I think it applies to all of us. One of the best ways to get over oneself is to care about others. Being alert and watchful will lead to being sensitive to what's happening in other people's lives. I want to finish out. Our time is up. Just very quickly, our point number three, the last thing that Paul does, he entrusts them to God. Let's read his closing words here. And now I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and to give you the inheritance among all those who are sanctified. If we had time, that's a verse I would have liked to focus on, maybe at a later date. Verse 33, I coveted no one's silver or gold or apparel. You yourselves know that these hands ministered to my necessities and to those who were with me. In all things I have shown you that by working hard in this way, we must help the weak and remember the words of the Lord Jesus, how he himself said, it's more blessed to give than to receive. And when he had said these things, he knelt down and prayed with them all. And there was much weeping on the part of it. There was much weeping on the part of all. They embraced Paul and they kissed him, being sorrowful most of all because of the word he had spoken. They would not see his face again. And they accompanied him to the ship. Amen. The central question that I asked you today is very simply, how is your life different because you are a follower of Jesus? If you've never met Jesus, I invite you to know him. I invite you to call upon him, to seek him, to invite him into your life, and to give yourself to him, to the one who's given himself to you. Doing so will change you. He will literally change your life. But if you are a Christian and there's no real change in your life, and the life that you live today is quite frankly undiscernible from those who don't know Jesus, I challenge you today to wake up, to be alert. The young man, Eutychus, was very fortunate that Paul was present to wake him up after he had fallen. Likewise, so too are you. The Lord is near. He's knocking on the door. He wants you to enjoy his life and to enter into yours. Will you let him? I invite you to do this today. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the testimony of Paul, for his changed life, changed by your grace, changed by the presence of your Spirit. And we desire in our own lives to encounter you and to be so likewise changed. Lord, help us to walk in humility, to pursue your purpose above all, to cherish the gift of your Spirit in our lives, and to teach us to be alert and ready and looking not only to our own comforts or plans, but to what you have called us to look towards, Father, your purpose for us in Christ. Strengthen us to finish the race that has been set out before us, even through trials, knowing that you are with us every step. May we value the surpassing worth of knowing Christ above anything else in this world, trusting in you that we may find peace and purpose, Father. I thank you for this morning. I thank you for your presence. I ask your hand upon these people. Encourage their hearts. Encourage their souls in you, Father, today. In Christ's name, amen.
Gone and
I'd like to invite you to stand with us as we close out this morning with our hymn of invitation. This is a song of invitation, a song of response. You are invited to come forward if you'd like to be prayed with or prayed for, or just meet with us after the service today. We'd love to pray with you and hear what God's doing in your life. It's also a time and opportunity for people who feel like this is where God's called them to worship, to be a part of, like to join us as a community of faith. We'd love for you to make that known today. But most importantly, if you don't know the Lord and you're looking for a real change in your life, it happens through knowing Him. You're born again, you're transformed, you're made new. I invite you to make that decision today. You can do that publicly by talking with us, coming forward, or do that privately after the service. But if He's talking to you today, don't leave without making that decision to follow Him. Let's sing together, Footsteps of Jesus. I was just asked by a teacher from South Point to pray for their school tomorrow. And my heart's broken. I'm angry. You know, violence in our schools is just so upsetting. And just thinking about our teachers and the teachers, her and other teachers at South Point, going back to the school, caring for those students, trying to get things back to normal. But also our other teachers, our other school workers, and our other schools, just how important that role is today. You are the presence of Christ where He has placed you. The world has changed through Christ working in you. We need you. Christ has called you and placed you to be in those places. So let's close out today praying for South Point, but also praying for our school system as well. Let's pray. Gracious Father, I lift up the school teachers at South Point. I pray for them. I pray for the students who are there. I ask your hand upon them as they return to a place of violence, Lord, and safety and anxiety and the worries, Lord, and teachers who are called not only to teach and instruct, but to care and to love and to guide and to direct, all these things that fall upon their plate, Father. I ask that you give them wisdom and patience and understanding and your spirit to be about this task. And Lord, I pray not only for the school in South Point, but I pray for our schools in our area, Father. I lift them up to you. I'm grateful for those who teach. I'm grateful for those who administer. I'm grateful for those who drive buses and come alongside children as coaches and are just present, Father. I pray that you work through them to care for the young lives that are within our community. I thank you for today. I ask your hand to be upon these people here today. Fill them with your spirit according to your purposes. In Christ's name, amen.